Yo, what's up? This is Patrick from Guy in the Cube, and in this video, I'm going to talk about cascading some slices, some do's and some don'ts. Stay tuned. If you're finding this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date from all the videos from both Adam and this guy. All right, cascading slices. There's lots of great content, lots of videos, lots of blog posts, but I just want to kind of consolidate all my thoughts on them in this video. So you guys know what I like to do. Instead of all this talking, let's do what? Let's head over to my laptop. Let's say you have a report like this. When you choose an item from one slicer, you'd like it to filter all the corresponding slices on the page, because let's say I select this NA value right here. It returns blank. And we want to produce a better experience for our report consumers, and this is just not the experience that we want them to have. We always want the combination of slicers to produce, to yield some types of results. The first thing that I often see people do is this. They go here, let's find our date table. They'll go and do this. Any attributes that are used for slices, they'll set the cross filter direction to bold. So now when I go here, if I choose 2020, you'll see how all this change, NA is gone. If I choose France, the list updates. But what's nice about this is, regardless of the combination of things that I select across those slicers, it should always yield some results in the table at the center of the report. And this works, but there's some challenges with this, and there's a possibility that it may yield unexpected results. ALBERTO and Marco and lots of other people have published content about this, and you should just avoid it at all costs if you can, because there's better ways. There's more elegant ways to solve this, all right? So something else you can use is you can use visual level filters. And I did a video on visual level filters, and it's pretty cool, and they work pretty seamlessly if the filter that you're gonna use, the value that you're gonna use as a filter, the DAX is not too complex. If you're not going across multiple fact tables, let me show you what I'm talking about. So let's say I have this page right here. It's pretty similar to the first one. And so you can see I have year and sales country and full name. And so if I wanted to simulate what I did with the bi-directional, all I need to do is choose one of these slicers, go to filters on visual, find a measure. Let's just choose total sales amount, and then say is not blank and apply. And then we will repeat that for each one of the slicers on the page. So I keep doing this and say it's not blank, apply, and then also on this one, total sales amount. So you need to do this on every single one. And so now I get the exact same behavior. See how NA is going? If I choose 2017, right, people will change, United Kingdom, people will change. But regardless of the combination, it always yields a proper result for me. Now, the challenge with this is, like I said before, if you have multiple fact tables, I mean, you'll need to bring in measures from each fact onto each one of those slicers. Or if your DAX is complex, it could really slow things down, and this could present a challenge. But the bigger thing is the DAX that's produced for those slicers. Check this out. So if we just go over here and we go to external tools, and we turn on DAX Studio. So we're gonna get DAX Studio opening while we do something else. We're gonna go to view, and we're gonna go to performance analyzer. I'm gonna start recording, and we're just gonna refresh one of these slices because I just wanna see the DAX, right? We're gonna copy that DAX, go ahead and paste it. What you'll see is that it's adding a keep filters here for the total sales amount. If I added multiple measures, you would see that for every measure there. And so, like I said, if the DAX is complicated or if there's multiple fact tables and it requires you to add multiple measures there, it can slow things down. So you gotta be really cautious when you use this, okay? The next thing I wanna talk about is what I like to call the ALBERTO. ALBERTO has a great post out there. It's about filtering slices without using bi-directional filters in Power BI. And you should definitely go read this article, but let me walk you through this. Did it. And so instead of dragging each one of these measures or multiple measures, because you have multiple fact tables, what you would do is you can create a little measure. So I'm going to create this little measure here. It's called the ALBERTO equals, and it's a really clean little measure that he makes. He says, if it's not is empty, your fact table. Mine is internet sales. And press enter. This is gonna return a 1 or a 0. If it's empty, it'll return a 0. If it's not empty, it'll return a 1. And then what you would do on that page is you would need to add this particular measure to all of them, but it's a much more efficient query. I mean, the DAX is definitely not complicated. So what I would do here is I would go right here to the ALBERTO, drop it there, say is 1, and choose apply. And then I would repeat that for each one of these. So like if I just went to this one, if you wanted to actually see it working, I'll drop that one there, say is one, and click apply. And you'll see that NA is going from here. And I repeat that step, all the slices. This is a very elegant solution. If you haven't read that blog post, you should definitely go read that blog post. There's a lot of great article, as you know, the Italians call it, in the article. You should go read that article. And you may be thinking, well, Patrick, the DAX one, what about the visual level filters where you're using the measure? Well, this one is a little more elegant. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Because if I did have multiple fact tables, all I need to do is say not is empty, and then the other fact table, right? I don't have another one in this model, but if I had another fact table, and then it will just pick it up. And so when you do the filtering, it just, you know, constantly inherently picks up that new fact table as part of this, where in the other approach with my visual filters, you were adding measures. And so if you had multiple fact tables, you would need to add multiple measures to those filters. In this case, you only need to add one, and it just works. It's pretty cool. Another thing that I ran across was the old snowflake. So let me show you what I'm talking about with this snowflake. So in the model, this one right here is a snowflake, and this one right here is a snowflake. And snowflake, because of the direction of the relationships, you'll notice how product filters subcategory, subcategory filters product, and product filters internet sales, and geography filters customer, and customers filters internet sales. And so if I go over to the report where I use product category, subcategory, and product name from individual tables, and I select accessories, you'll notice how subcategory and product name, they filter. They're filtered by product category, and that's because of the direction of the relationship. So it's going to filter that one, which will cause this one to filter that one, right? It just works. Now, if I go to here and choose bike racks, it will filter product name, but it does not filter product category. And it's the same reason. It's because of the direction of the relationship. Subcategory can filter product and on forward, as long as that arrow, that relationship, is going in the right direction. But it will not filter subcategory because of the direction of the relationship. I can turn bidirectional on here, but you want to avoid that. Remember I said at the beginning of the video. What you do in this case is denormalize. You would flatten this out. They're one column dimensions. So I can take the product and the subcategory, flatten it into my product category table, either in Power Query or using DAX. My preference is I would try to do it in Power Query first and then do it in DAX. But once it's flattened, let me show you what will happen is you kind of have, you're just denormalizing your table. And so now if I choose breaks, it's going to filter category and product name. And then if I choose product name, it'll filter category and subcategory because they're all just in a flat table. And so if I go over to my product table, you'll see that I have my subcategory, category, and product name, and they're all hidden because I created a hierarchy, but they're all in one flat table and it just works. So that's a lot of stuff, but I want to talk about one more thing before we wrap this video up, and that's natural hierarchies. And so the most common one is the date dimension. So if you have a natural hierarchy when you're doing the ETL, if it naturally rolls up, you should do that in the back end. So when you're building your data warehouse, if you have a data warehouse in your environment, you should just kind of load it flat if it's a natural hierarchy. A lot of times you can't, you know, like in an example where I had customer and geography, that's not a natural hierarchy, but product, subcategory, and category are date, month, quarter, they typically are. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So you can see in this natural hierarchy right here, if I filter 2021, I know we haven't finished out 2021. So if I filter it, you'll see how it only shows two quarters. But if I filter 2020, it'll show four quarters. If I go over here and choose November, look what happens to the quarter. It's only quarter four, and 2021 is gone because we don't have data for 2021. So regardless of the slice or where I pick the value from, it always will filter up and down the levels in that hierarchy. That is because it's all in the flat table. It's denormalized, similar to what I did with the product category. All right, what do you guys think? What are you guys doing with filtering slicers? I tried to make this an exhaustive video. I know it's a little longer, but I'd love to know how you're solving this, what techniques you're using. Let's continue the conversation. Where? In the comments below. If it's your first time visiting the Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. If you like my video, you know, big thumbs up. As always, from Adam and myself, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.